views expressed on this program are those of the hosts, guests, and callers, and are not necessarily those of this station, its management, or other advertisers. You're listening to Transformation Talk Radio.
On the cutting edge of the new mainstream, Christine Upchurch is passionate about bringing together science, psychology, and spirituality in a way that can be applied to our everyday lives for true transformation. The Christine Upchurch Show, stellar conversations to illuminate your journey, engages some of the most inspired visionaries on the planet in lighthearted, lively dialogue. Join us as we explore the expansive nature of reality in a down-to-earth way, offering you insights and tools empowering you to become that bright light you're meant to be. Now, here's your host, Christine Upchurch.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Christine Upchurch Show, where we have stellar conversations to illuminate your journey. I'm speaking to you today from, I'm not sure if it's sunny, hazy, smoky Seattle.
All of the above.
Yes.
On
KKNW AM 1150. You may be listening on the East Coast in Connecticut, Rhode Island, or New York on WBLQ 1230 AM radio, on one of the 35 stations in Australia, or anywhere around the world on Transformation Talk Radio. And if you're not listening live, you might be listening in the archives on ChristineUpchurch.com. But whenever and wherever you're listening from, I'm so glad you're joining us here today. We are going to have an important conversation, and I bet you many of you, even if from the scientific realm, many of you who studied science in high school, in college, who are, you know, interested in science today, have never heard about this stuff, and it's pretty doggone important. But before I give that away, I have to say hello to my better half here in the studio, who allows you to hear these wonderful conversations, Mr. Benny Mathers. Good morning, Benny.
Good day, Christine. I'm staying cool. Yes, thank you very much for asking, because I knew you were going to. I'm a little nervous still about this area, but we're doing just fine, and I'm looking very forward to the show today.
Yeah, and we are experiencing a lot of smoke. For those people who don't live in the area, smoke from the British Columbia fires.
The wildfires up north seemingly drifted south over the, like, basically entire Puget Sound region. And what's crazy is NASA picked up some satellite photos. Uh-huh. I'll get it out. And it's national attention as the last couple of days, which is crazy. You see the map. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, but and my eyes are stinging whenever I'm outside.
And also what we're hearing, too, as far as, like, how much is in the air is more than most, like, smog-filled areas. Like LA.
Beijing.
Yeah, Beijing. Like, so, you know, just want to make sure we're all okay, but hopefully it'll dissipate quickly.
Yeah, and it just goes to show you how connected we are in the world, because these are fires that are, you know, hundreds of miles away from us, and yet it's affecting our air quality here. Yep. And we see the same thing relating to water, you know, after the tsunami that affected,
the Fukushima thing?
Fukushima, and how they were saying they were finding radiation in different parts of the ocean that was reaching our coast. It's just we're all so connected.
That's right.
Whether we want to be or not. And we need to pay attention to our world and show up for it in a way that honors that connection.
Can't escape it. It's a globe. It's round.
Yeah.
It's a world.
Yeah. And speaking of water, it reminds me of our guest today, and I'm so excited to have him here. His name is Dr. Gerald Pollack, and he's at the University of Washington here. I feel so grateful to have him be a local scientist with his own lab. He is recognized worldwide, though, as a dynamic speaker and author, and his passion lies in plumbing the depths of natural truths. And he's one of these guys who doesn't mind bucking the system if that is leading his pathway to truth. And I just so appreciate that about him. He received the first Emoto Peace Prize, and he's the recipient of University of Washington's highest honor, the annual Faculty Lecturer Award, which means when he speaks to students, students light up, they understand, and the same thing is true when he does presentations outside of the university as well. He's the founding editor-in-chief of the research journal Water, and he's the director of the Institute for Venture Science. He's written a couple of wonderful books, including Cells, Gels, and the Engines of Life, and his most recent book is called The Fourth Phase of Water. I'm so grateful to have him here today. Dr. Gerald Pollack. Hi, Jerry. Welcome to the Christine Upchurch Show.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you for the wonderful introduction. And And before you ask your first question, may I comment on the smoke?
Oh, yes, please.
Yeah, so we never really think about smoke or smog a whole lot. Question is, you know, the particulate matter that's sitting in the air, it's heavier than air. Uh-huh. And so question is, how come gravitation doesn't bring it immediately down to the surface? What keeps it suspended?
Right.
And that's a question that a lot of people never really think about. And our research has led me to figure out the answer to that. It's not exactly related to the water, but it's closely related. And that is, you know, these particles that sit in the air are charged. They're usually negatively charged.
Okay.
And you say, well, okay, big deal. So they're negatively charged. But the big deal is that the Earth is also negatively charged.
Uh-huh.
And I didn't know about that until about 10 years ago when a Russian colleague told me about the Earth's negative charge. My original education was in electrical engineering, and if anybody had told me that the Earth was not neutral and had a negative charge, I would have laughed. And so I laughed at Andre when he told me that. But next day I found out from the lectures of Richard Feynman, the great physicist of the last half century, and he had a whole chapter in his book of lectures on the subject. So the issue is this: the Earth is negatively charged, uh-huh, and the particles are negatively charged, and they repel each other. And
right,
it's a simple answer. That's why they stay up. We never think of this issue, but it is something to give thought to, because otherwise the gravitation should pull them right down to the Earth, and
yes,
the smoke in Seattle today shouldn't be there.
That makes perfect sense, because of course positive and negative attract, and two things of the same charge repel each other.
Right, precisely.
Wow. You know, when reading your book, I was fascinated with your history. And I know that whether you're in the field of consciousness, whether you're in the field of politics, or whether you're in the field of science, you know, each of us has a journey that gets us to where we're at, gets us to, you know, either sort of doing what's expected of us or kind of forging our own path of our passion. How did you get to this place of water? You talk about, you know, being in a different field before.
Yeah. Well, I came to realize I was in the field of muscle contraction, trying to figure out how the molecules inside the muscle come together to produce force and to produce motion, which our muscles do. And one thing struck me is that our muscles are filled with the proteins that make them work, in theory, that is actin and myosin. But actually, more populous than actin and myosin and the other proteins, more populous is the water that's inside. So we all know that, excuse me, our body is about 90% or 60% water. Younger people, maybe 70% or so.
Okay.
But that's by volume. And,
right.
And if you do, actually, if you count molecules instead of volume, you know, water molecules are so small that if you line up all the molecules in the muscle,
uh-huh,
and you start counting them, more than 99 out of 100 are water molecules. It's not just muscle, it's every cell in our body. So,
wow, so we are mostly water. I mean, not just like 70%. In some level, we're like more than 99% water.
Correct, right.
Yeah.
More than, so the current view of most of biology, and particularly in muscles, is that the water is practically irrelevant. You think if you look at the books and papers and such on water, that these protein molecules are acting in a vacuum with nothing around them, but they're sitting in water, and to think that the water is completely irrelevant to how our muscles contract is kind of arrogant, you know, to say, 99% of the molecules don't really matter. They're just sitting there like a bathtub full of the water that bathes the more important molecules of life.
Right.
And so just at that time, I came into contact with someone I'd heard of before but didn't know, a guy named Gilbert Ling.
Mm-hmm.
And Gilbert is now 98 years old and still kicking. And Gilbert had, by that time, he'd written five books, I can't remember, about the water that's inside our cells. And he said, contrary to public scientific opinion, is that the water molecules are different inside the cell, different from the water molecules in a glass. Uh-huh. They're actually lined up in some way. They're ordered. He called it structured or structured water.
Wow.
And I thought, oh, this makes good sense. And his arguments and his evidence, they were impeccable. And that's how we got started. So it was a progressive shift for me from thinking about muscles to thinking about water. Of uh-huh. course, muscles are important, but water is even more important because water is everywhere. It's yes. not only in muscle cells, it's in every cell of our body.
Uh-huh.
And so that was the progressive transition. And by now, we've more or less stopped studying muscle contraction and have been studying water ever since.
You know, Jerry, I would think that water would have been well studied. I mean, you know, we learn in chemistry and biology about water. It's something that's been so basic, and yet has it been researched thoroughly?
Yes and no. Water was pretty well researched up to about 50 years ago. It's kind of strange to hear that. It was studied, and even 100 years ago, there was a lot of focus on water, and one physical chemist suggested is Sir William Hardy, and since he's got a Sir before his name, he must have been pretty important.
And, right.
Yeah, and so he was a colloid chemist, and he said, you know, there are too many anomalies that are associated with water. Stuff that doesn't really fit into the accepted theory. The theory being that we have three phases of water: solid, liquid, and vapor. Uh-huh. And more than 100 years ago, he said, you know, there must be a fourth phase of water.
Really? And that long ago?
It was really that long ago. And uh-huh. I haven't searched back beyond that, but uh-huh. it wouldn't surprise me if, you know, if there's more before that. And, you know, so the question is, well, what's an anomaly? Well, an anomaly is an observed feature that doesn't fit the prevailing theory. And so when you have one or two anomalies, it's okay. Maybe the anomalies will somehow resolve within the framework of the theory.
Uh-huh.
Right now, there are something like 70 anomalies of water. And when the number grows that high, you begin to think about, is there something wrong with the commonly accepted vision of water?
Uh-huh.
You see, and the number is actually that high. There are some websites that list the anomalies. For example, by anomalies, the density of water is highest at 4 degrees centigrade, and that's not expected. And
uh-huh.
and the solid phase, usually solid phases are denser than liquid phases, but in this case, ice, the solid phase is less dense, and that's uh-huh. why ice floats.
Right.
Yeah. So those are just a couple of something close to 70 of these anomalies. And so the number has grown to the point where you really have to ask the question, is there something that is wrong with the theory? Uh-huh. But I'm digressing from your question. Your question was, water should be well studied. And water was very well studied up until the 1950s, when the father of modern biochemistry, Albert St. George, Nobel Prize, discoverer of vitamin C,
uh-huh.
he came out with a famous phrase. He said, life is water dancing to the tune of solids. So ooh. So he knew that water was absolutely central to everything
right.
the body did. And then a few things happened that really stopped science of water in its tracks. And there were a couple of scientific debacles that took place. Let me just briefly say, because they're kind of interesting. One came from Russia, and the most famous Russian physical chemist reported in around 1960 or so, the time of the Cold War, that if you take water and you put it into these fine glass capillary tubes,
uh-huh.
the properties of that water change markedly. The density increases, the boiling point is very high, the freezing point is very low,
uh-huh.
and it acted really like something. It's just water. It was said to be pure water that was evaporated and then condensed into these tubes.
Uh-huh.
And it was said to have these weird properties, and so a lot of people thought, wow, this is pretty interesting, because who ever heard of water with these strange properties? And the problem is that it was the time of the Cold War, and so the Russians were not supposed to have produced anything that was so interesting and so revolutionary. Yeah. And so when finally the papers were translated into English with the Cold War mentality, there were really two choices. One is to demonstrate that the Russians were buffoons and made obvious error. Mm-hmm. The other is to take it seriously, do something with it, and maybe leapfrog the Russians and come up with something even more interesting. Mm-hmm. So the latter was actually the first route. And someone reported in Science, the journal Science, which is perhaps one of the top journals in the world, uh-huh. that all of these interesting properties, and they gave it a name, they called it poly water, because the water molecules acted as though they were connected in some way, as in a polymer. So mm-hmm. 2 months after that, the Western world concluded that it was a scientific error, an artifact. And that happened because someone said, oh, this water that was inside of these glass capillary tubes, mm-hmm. it was contaminated because the glass tubes, some of the silica from the glass actually was leached into the water mm-hmm. out from. So in other words, the glass was somewhat soluble. And they said, so it's a real mistake because it wasn't really pure water. It was a silica gel that they were studying. And then following that, another group added salt to their water.
Okay, hold off on that story. We have to go to a quick break, but more with Dr. Gerald Pollack here in just a few moments. Did you know what you learned in school was wrong, and there is actually a fourth phase of water beyond liquid, vapor, and ice? I know. I too was shocked when I learned this. What makes this new discovery so exciting? In scientific terms, this cutting-edge research explains the energetic potency of water. In practical terms, this missing link of water is now breaking open the floodgates for us to have a more complete understanding of our health, our weather, and the physics of our world. Join researcher, award-winning presenter, and author Professor Gerald Pollack of the University of Washington as he shares new scientific insights about how this fourth phase of water, the sun's energy, and geomagnetism affect our planet and how this affects you at East West Bookshop in Seattle on Saturday, August 5th at 7 p.m. For more information or to register, go to eastwestbookshop.com or call 206-523-3726.
Chris Stainis is a spiritual leader and healer and teaches a course on how you can transform your life through a meditation and healing system that will manifest your spirit's dreams. She manifested the Women of Wisdom Conference, the Women of Wisdom book, and this radio show. And she can show you how to change your life too. Are you ready? Visit the website and contact her at voicesofwomentoday.com. That's voicesofwomentoday.com.
The goal for the Art of Powerful Living Radio is to inspire every human to live lives that are rich, fulfilling, on purpose, and fun. This hit show with Robert Schoenfeld is a fresh approach to boldly living our lives with creativity, courage, patience, wisdom, love, and power. Join Robert every month with Dr. Pat Basile for the Art of Powerful Living Radio.
I'm Christine Upchurch, and this is a Stellar Reflections Minute. As a former research statistician, my scientific background is what many would call sensible. For more than a decade now, I have been working in the field of energy medicine, facilitating sessions and teaching around the world. People from the mainstream often ask me, how did a sensible woman like you end up working in such an alternative field? Implicit in their question is the underlying assumption that the field of subtle energy, such as energy healing and intuition, isn't sensible. But I believe it is very sensible. Even scientists are able to measure aspects of this. Approaching life from an energetic perspective brings us new opportunity for healing and transformation. And from a practical standpoint, even if you can't rationally explain how something works, if you experience a shift from it, then doesn't it make it pretty sensible? Please visit StellarReflections.com or call 425-999-9836. That's 425-999-9836.
Welcome back to the Christine Upchurch Show here on KKNW and Transformation Talk Radio. I'm really enjoying this interesting conversation today with Dr. Gerald Pollack, water researcher. Now, Jerry, you know, you're bucking the system in a variety of ways, which I've got such great respect for, because I believe that if we don't question the assumptions of the tribe, we don't question the belief systems of the tribe can't evolve. So you are helping evolve physical science as well as health science. So, you know, you were talking about some of the weird properties of water, and I interrupted you. If you want to finish that story, that would be great.
Sure. I was talking about the Poly water incident, which stopped water research in its tracks. I mean, suddenly. And I'll just finish. And so this interesting finding by the Russians was challenged by people in the West who thought the Russians, you know, they're so incompetent, they can't possibly find anything of value. And there was one scientist who put salt in water, and they measured some physical chemical property, absorption spectra. And it turned out very similar to what the Russians found. And they said, The Russians must have been sweating into their water.
Oh, dear.
And that put the nails in the coffin of poly water. And so after that, it became really difficult to study water because, you know, if the most famous Russian physical chemist could screw up so badly, then what about the mere mortals like us? And so, I remember as a graduate student when this thing was happening that there were some people in my department studying water, and I was advised by a Japanese scientist who came to me out of the blue, and he said, you know, in your career, you have a nice career ahead of you. You can study anything, but stay away from water, because if you tread in the water, it's really dangerous for your career. Now, multiply that by many, many people, and suddenly water research went dead.
Right.
And so I don't want to take the time to, there was another one that's even more colorful about water memory, the idea that water had the capacity to store information.
Ooh, that's fascinating.
Well, I mean, it's another story, and one scientist got practically crucified for it, and his career ended, unfortunately. And that was another obstacle to the progress of water research, because it became kind of a scientific joke. Oh, you're studying water, and the idea of water memory. So one suggests. Came out that, you know, you're having trouble remembering things. Well, drink some water, because then you know, water memory, you can restore your memory by drinking water. So it became a scientific joke.
Oh,
and
dear.
Together with poly water and the water memory debacle, a lot of people stayed away from water. It's only now that the subject is becoming interesting again to scientists.
Right. So, you know, somehow you were willing to buck the system to a certain degree and follow on this path that interests you. And you have done such groundbreaking research. Now, you talked a little bit about the fourth phase of water. So let's just go through basically the three phases that we've been taught in school and this fourth phase and how that relates to our health and well-being.
Okay, that's a question. That's a long one. Let me start. Keep it brief. Okay. So, what's the fourth phase of water? Well, we all learned that water has three phases: solid, liquid, and vapor. And I mentioned earlier that a fourth phase had been suggested more than 100 years ago, and this fourth phase was suggested to be some kind of ordered or structured phase, and Gilbert Ling, who I mentioned, had provided a lot of evidence in that, and we picked up on that and started studying. So here's what we found. We found that when water meets a surface, a solid surface, not all surfaces, but almost all, not all, hydrophilic, that is water-loving surfaces, and those are the kind of surfaces, you know, if you drop a droplet of water on a hydrophilic or water-loving surface, it spreads out. And a hydrophobic surface, fearing water, it's like Teflon, the water beads up.
Right.
So not those, but the surface is where the water spreads out. So what we found is that when the water comes in contact with the hydrophilic surface, it undergoes a transformation. The molecules of water that hit the surface become ordered by the surface. But the ordering of the water molecules, it's not just one molecular layer. it actually projects out many, many, many molecular layers, far more than anybody could ever have imagined. We've seen up to millions, literally millions of layers. So it's not a trivial amount. It's a very substantial amount of the water that undergoes this transformation from ordinary water, liquid water, where the molecules are bouncing around, to this ordered phase of water.
Well, and it's funny because with the research that I know that some others like Bill Tiller, you know, have done there, they've been looking for what factors help create more order in terms of like what they call negative entropy. So the entropy of water is what you're talking about, where things are sort of kind of random, versus the negative entropy, which is a really positive thing in terms of our health and well-being, which is the order.
Absolutely. Yeah, I was going to get to it. This water, this is the water, by the way, that fills our body. And so if you don't know and appreciate that, then it's not possible to figure out mechanisms in a meaningful way. So the issue of health comes in when you speak about the role of this water. Let me just add two things to that, which can help to understand how the water plays a really important role in our health. And that is, the first one is that the water is not neutral, it's actually charged, it's negatively charged. And the second one is that to build up this negatively charged water, you need energy of some kind. And we found that the energy comes from light, particularly, particularly infrared light.
Okay.
So, digress, where does infrared light come from?
Sure.
Well, most people, you know, you look in the toaster and you see these glowing orange coils and it's hot and you think, oh, yeah, that's generating infrared or in the electric range or so.
Sure.
Okay, but actually it's all over the place. It's coming from the walls. It's coming from the desk. And if you were to darken a room and take out an infrared camera, that is a camera whose sensor is sensitive to infrared instead of visible light, you get a beautiful image even in the dark. Uh-huh. That means everything is generating infrared, which means that the energy required for building this fourth phase of water is omnipresent, always there.
Okay.
If you increase the energy, you get more of the water.
Right.
See? And if you don't have enough of this infrared energy, then you have less. So then the question in terms of the role in health boils down to something like this. You know, our cells are filled with this kind of a fourth phase. We call it, by the way, we call it EZ water, and EZ stands for exclusion zone. And we call it exclusion zone, or EZ, because it's easy to remember, but easy. But actually, it's because the first property that we found experimentally was it excludes almost everything from it. It's just like ice. When ice forms, it's a perfect crystal, and so as it forms, in order to form the perfect crystal, it's got to push everything else out.
Uh-huh.
You see, and this water is very much the same. So it excludes, and so we call it exclusion zone or EZ water. So I use the term fourth phase or EZ.
Uh-huh.
I use them interchangeably.
Okay.
So we've got in our cells, we have this EZ water. It's by far the most water that's inside the cell. And it sits around our proteins. And so the proteins are, as you know, the work of the cell is done essentially by the proteins. The proteins fold. They go from, let's say, an extended state to a contracted state. But in order to folded state, and then they go back again. And that's how, for example, if you have a muscle cell, then the muscle proteins, actin and myosin, they go from an extended state to some kind of folded state, and that's what mediates contraction.
Okay.
But you see, they don't do it alone. They do it in the presence of EZ water because they're surrounded by EZ water. So if you have an ample amount of EZ water in your cell to surround the protein, then the protein can act in a normal way, and you get a normal muscle contraction or normal secretion from a secretory cell or normal information transmission from a nerve cell. The proteins are acting properly. However,
hold that thought. We have to go to another quick break, and we'll listen to the downside about what happens if we don't have enough EZ water in our system. More with Dr. Gerald Pollack here in just a few moments.
We don't even talk anymore. you like increased health and vitality? How would you like to avoid the onset of disease as well as slow the aging process? This is all possible through a simple, safe, and natural process. Every day, we are either moving toward wellness or away from wellness.
Hi, I'm Mary Jane Mack. I'd like to be your partner in achieving optimal health. Contact me now at MaryJaneMack.com or call 425-392-0659. Visit MaryJaneMack.com.
Did you know what you learned in school was wrong, and there is actually a fourth phase of water beyond liquid, vapor, and ice? I know. I, too, was shocked when I learned this. What makes this new discovery so exciting? In scientific terms, this cutting-edge research explains the energetic potency of water. In practical terms, this missing link of water is now breaking open the floodgates for us to have a more complete understanding of our health, our weather, and the physics of our world. Join researcher, award-winning presenter, and author Professor Gerald Pollack of the University of Washington as he shares new scientific insights about how this fourth phase of water, the sun's energy, and geomagnetism affect our planet and how this affects you at East West Bookshop in Seattle on Saturday, August 5th at 7 p.m. For more information or to register, go to eastwestbookshop.com or call 206-523-3726.
Do you want to heal your body and mind? Your body has a lot to tell you if you just learn to listen to your intuition. Audrey Michelle, host of Rewired Life Radio, can help you peel away the layers that are holding you back from living your best life. Tune in to Rewired Life Radio. Learn to love, heal, celebrate on Transformation Talk Radio every Wednesday at 12 p.m. Pacific, 3 p.m. Eastern. Connect with Audrey at audreymichelle.com.
I'm Peggy Snow with another Stellar Reflections Minute. Presence, or what we think of as being fully in the moment, is a key element in the process of healing work. As a practitioner facilitating a session, genuine presence takes us out of our heads, where we tend to decide what is and maybe what should be for the client, and moves us into direct experience where we're available to witness the person in their wholeness. In this receptive realm, our senses are heightened and expanded, allowing us to perceive what's seeking to unfold and to interact in the moment. There's something profoundly powerful that happens when healing is approached in this simple, pure way. Balance can be restored and healing can take place on multiple levels. If you'd like more information about the services we offer at Stellar Reflections, visit us at stellarreflections.com or call 425-999-9836. That's 425-999-9836.
Welcome back to the Christine Upchurch Show here on KKNW and Transformation Talk Radio. Today, I'm having a fabulous conversation with groundbreaking researcher whose research actually has important implications to your health and well-being, and also to help science understand what makes the world go round. And we'll talk more about that a little later. It's so fascinating to hear about how this structured water, this easy water, as you refer to it, relates to our health and well-being. And you were in the middle of talking about how it can benefit the protein function of anything, including, like, say, muscle cells. What happens if we don't have enough of that easy water in our system or in that particular, you know, like, area that's...
Then the proteins can't function properly because they're in an environment that's unnatural, and so the proteins, instead of folding, they misfold. They don't fold properly, which means that your muscles or your nerves or whatever cell we're talking about don't function properly. And so if you want to get them to function properly, you have to restore the water. We don't ordinarily think of it in terms of easy water or restoration, but hydration, I guess, is what we're talking about, really. And everybody knows that we need to be properly hydrated in order to function, especially when you get long in the tooth.
Right. Yeah.
So So what you need, the strategies that are involved in doing that are actually pretty simple to build it. So, for example, one is drinking water. It's as simple as that, because the water is the raw material for building easy water.
Sure.
So that's the first. And, you know, a lot of people feel if you've had two tennis matches and you're pretty beat, uh-huh. you sit down and drink some water, and pretty soon you're restored. And the restoration is because your cells now are better hydrated, or translated into our terminology, you build more easy water so the proteins can do their thing in the way
sure.
they're designed to do their thing.
Right.
So another one is the sauna. You know, the sauna, it exposes you to a warm environment, which is full of infrared energy.
Uh-huh.
Infrared energy is the energy that you need to build easy water. So you may walk in tired and cranky and with sore muscles, and uh-huh. 20 minutes later, you, as I've experienced myself, you come out refreshed and renewed. And
which seems a little counterintuitive, in the sense that you sweat water out, you know, so you're actually losing some water while you're in the sauna.
You do lose some water, it's true, and you need to drink afterward. But the water that comes out, you know, our sweat is low pH, and the sweat contains protons, and the acid environment is not good for our health. We actually need an alkaline environment. So sweating and getting rid of not only toxins but also protons and maintaining the negative charge is really important. And so the restoration comes not as you're sitting there, but after you've rehydrated yourself and
sure.
and have gotten all of that infrared energy.
So why is it important to maintain that negative charge? Because you've talked about that a couple
because
of times.
Because easy water is negatively charged, and so in order to build that, negative charge helps. And that's why another approach to doing that is to connect yourself to a source of negative charge.
Uh-huh.
A simple way to do that is to ground yourself. You know, some people are aware of this kind of therapy. We all have experienced walking barefoot on the beach.
Right.
We feel good afterward. And the reason we feel good is the opening remark I made to you about the smoke being suspended. The earth is negatively charged. And so if you can connect yourself to the earth by walking barefoot on the beach, or uh-huh. connecting yourself directly,
which
to
some people call earthing.
Earthing,
yes. Yeah.
Or grounding.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, there's a lot of research that's been on that. Done on that, and you're drawing from an infinite supply of negative charge from the earth to fill your body with negative charge. Easy water is negatively charged, so it facilitates the growth of easy water. And again, that's another reason why you may feel good when you do that.
Uh-huh.
And also, for people who live nearby in Seattle, we know that in the wintertime it's kind of gloomy around here.
It is.
Right. And when the sun comes out, we feel good. And the question is this purely a psychological issue, or is there some physicality to it? And I think the latter may be true, because we're absorbing light, especially infrared, from the sun's energy, and this does the same thing. So there are many ways, and one way that we're actually studying is, you know, there are many substances that have been known for millennia to be good for health, even from Ayurvedic times, from 8,000, 9,000 years ago. And the question is, why? How come?
Mm-hmm.
Well, we studied that, and we found in so far, every case we've studied turmeric, we've studied tulsi from basil, we've
uh-huh.
studied even aspirin, which comes from the bark of a willow tree,
uh-huh.
coconut water, and so on. All of these we found build easy water. See, so it's possible that the reason why these agents are so powerfully effective in improving our health all over our body holistically, not for one organ, is that they impact the water. They build easy water, and we need easy water, a full complement of easy water, in order to function properly.
Uh-huh.
So, yes, please, you're about to ask something.
So I'm thinking in terms of, say, fruits and vegetables. When we eat fruits and vegetables that clearly have water in them, does our body have to convert that to easy water, or is there easy water in there already?
Oh, you put your finger exactly on it. There is easy water. So you're referring not only to eating of raw vegetables, but to juicing, you know, squeezing the juice out of them, green juicing, so to speak. And what you're doing is you're squeezing the water from inside the cells of the plants. And these are fresh, new cells that have recently grown, and they're full of easy water. We measure that, and we can test to see that they're just like our cells are full of easy water. They're full of easy water. So what you're doing by drinking this green juice is you're taking the easy water from plant cells and transferring them directly to your cells. So it makes sense why. And I've heard from various health practitioners that often the patient will come, and it doesn't matter what their issue is. The first recommendation is to do green juicing. And I think Dr. Mercola's website also suggests something like that, that green juicing is the simplest thing you can do for your health. And these health practitioners tell me that they come back in a few months, and not only have they lost weight, but their health is much better, irrespective of what their issue is. So that's a really good point, Christine, about getting the water, basically stealing it from plants and using it for yourself.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, we think in terms of water quality, and I know that there's issues with things, simple things like bacteria, that certain things that we want to avoid in water. But are there some waters that are higher quality in terms of the easy structure than others?
Well, we think so, but the evidence is not really in. I think what one needs to do is do objective tests comparing various waters, and by objective tests, I mean tests on people's health. For example, it would include clinical studies. It would include animal studies. Some of these waters may be much better than others, but it's not established for sure. We think that waters that contain EZ make a lot of sense, that they would be really good for health. And so right now, it's not possible to actually create easy water in a laboratory. I mean, we can do it, and we actually have a company we formed to work on this, but it's not ready yet. But I know there are certain waters that have been demonstrated to not only improve health, but possibly even reverse pathologies. And I know this is an extreme statement, but I think
not on the show, Dr. Pollack.
Okay, well, there's one that has been demonstrated to reverse irreversible kidney pathology.
Wow!
At first, when the guy told me about it, I said, "I don't believe it." And he sent me the evidence, and he sent me more and more evidence. And he actually, we invited him. We conduct an annual conference, and it moved from, used to be in Vermont, now in Bulgaria, on water and the science of water. It's physics, chemistry, and biology of water. It's a really interesting conference. And he came there, and he presented evidence, and got a lot of people interested. And right now, it's become a commercial endeavor. But at any rate, that's only one example. I've seen others, and there are so many people producing different kinds of waters, and each one claims that their water is good for health, and some may actually be good. One water that I think is probably useful and simple is spring water, because spring water has a lot of minerals in it, and EZ forms around those minerals, you see. So that water is likely to contain a lot of EZ. And if EZ is good for health, as we think it is, that should be good water to drink.
That makes sense.
Spring water. And reverse osmosis water is less so, because it's devoid of all of those minerals, although some it restocked in some cases.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
So what about the surface that the water is in? Because you were talking before that, you know, that surface makes a difference. So say plastic versus glass.
Well, I've heard a lot about the negative effects of plastic. We haven't studied it in the laboratory. Other people have and recommend glass. And what glass actually does is if the surface of glass is right, the glass may itself nucleate the growth of easy water. And so that would be a positive thing. In terms of the plastics, usually they're hydrophobic, and so it would not do that. But the real concern is that some of the plastics may actually get in the water and may not be good for health. And besides the environmental damage that's done by the plastics. Right. So, you know, we drink that kind of water all the time, but I've seen pictures of what the Pacific Ocean looks like, regions of the Pacific Ocean, mm-hmm. with plastic debris and unimaginable concentrations.
Yeah.
So we don't want to despoil the environment any further.
Right, right. That makes sense. And by the way, we're skipping the next break because this conversation is too juicy.
Oh, my goodness.
So, but before we go further in this conversation, I want to make sure that you have a chance to talk about your event tomorrow night at East West Bookshop. If you're in the Seattle area, everybody, you don't want to miss Dr. Pollack's presentation tomorrow.
Well, yeah, it's 7 o'clock at East West Bookstore on, I think, 65th Street, Northeast 65th. And I'm going to be talking about, you know, I've given two already. I've talked about the essence of my book, The Fourth Phase of Water, which has become really popular.
Uh-huh.
And I talked about weather also. And this time I'm going to focus on literally on the question of what makes the earth turn, or what makes the world turn is, I guess, what I call it.
And I'm surprised that hasn't been figured out yet.
Well, it's been presumed that the reason the Earth turns every 24 hours is that something started it going, and it just keeps going, there are several pieces of evidence against that. You know, the idea is that the Earth has a lot of inertia, so the Earth was given a kick and it just keeps going, and there are no losses. But there are losses. There are tides and such. And so usually when, for example, if you spin a top, it goes nicely for a while, but eventually it slows down and stops. And, you know, the Earth has been doing this for billions of years, and you think that it ought to slow down unless there's an energy source that drives it.
Right.
Yeah, and so I think there is an energy source that drives it. And water is indirectly involved with it, but the most powerful... The most important thing is energy, and the energy comes from the sun, and the sun causes evaporation, and the evaporation causes charges in the atmosphere, and those charges are more dense in regions where the sun is shining and less dense in regions where it's dark.
Right.
So there's a gradient, a lateral gradient, and that gradient... You know, and the positive charges in the atmosphere, they always want to escape from one another because they repel. So they move from the lighted regions to the darkened regions. And as they do it, that gives us the prevailing westerly wind. And that wind is constantly going fiercely, 100 miles an hour or so. And that's why, you know, when we take a flight from Seattle to New York, it's quicker than coming from New York to Seattle.
Because
we're with the wind. But that wind is also, as it blows, it creates friction on the surface of the Earth, especially where there are mountains.
Sure.
And it pushes. You don't need a whole lot of push to do it. And so I'm going to argue that is the force that's responsible for turning the Earth.
Yeah. And I want to just mention to people that if you are in the Seattle area, you don't want to miss it. It's funny, Jerry, the way I found out about you was I was standing in line to East West Bookshop waiting for a presentation. I think I was going to see Dr. Judith Orloff. And people in line started talking about having been to your previous presentations and how fabulous they were. Like, people were saying, when's he coming next? When's he coming next?
My goodness. Wow.
And so you were very popular in the line. And it's funny because when I sort of began looking into, you know, what this was about, what your research was about, just sort of from the surface level, I got this big intuitive aha. And then my rational brain, as I looked into it, it's like, you are on to something really important. And I love the fact that you have kind of moved forward in an area of research where you've had some resistance. Speaking of resistance, like, you know, the friction, scientifically, are people beginning to get behind you, or are you still experiencing that friction?
Well, it's some of both. You know, the in the academic world, people feel good sticking to what they feel comfortable with traditionally. And so there's been some pushback. It's not not a lot, but uh-huh. some, and many of the scientists are kind of have a standoff attitude. Let's wait and see, uh-huh. see what happens. But on the other hand, in some other realms, this stuff has been warmly embraced, so much so that I just can't answer all the emails that I receive and the phone calls. And those two areas are one in the spiritual area, because water is so closely connected with spirituality, uh-huh. and the second is alternative and integrative medicine, right. where the recognition that water is so central to our function and our health. So many of these people have picked it up, I'm really flattered by their interest, and I guess I've come to believe myself that the water really is central and so previously so unrecognized, yet so important and mm-hmm. so easy to explain so many features of our health and our sickness, and also the possibility of doing simple things to improve our health that right. don't necessarily depend on the chemicals from the pharmaceutical industry.
Yeah, and one of the things I'm so fascinated by relating to your research is the importance of light to this type of water. And I know that in our society, you know, people have been shunning the sun, maybe not here in the Seattle area. When the sun comes out, we go running out the doors. yeah. But, you know, generally speaking, we've been taught to avoid the sun, and it can cause cancers. But the infrared from our sunlight is important, right?
It's absolutely important. Yeah, it's a, you know, natural experience. Enjoy the sun, and uh-huh. and it's unnatural to avoid the sun. So, yeah, I think on balance, it's pretty likely that the health benefits of the light that we receive from the sun are really important.
Uh-huh. Have you looked at the light that's generated through energy healing and its effect on easy water?
Well, we started doing some of that. So we brought some healers into the laboratory. We have a piece of equipment called a radiometer. It measures the radiant energy that is being generated by these healers. Uh-huh. To see if there's something unique about it, and those experiments are still underway. There have been some technical issues, uh-huh. but we hypothesize that the energy healing, that there is some kind of energy that is emanating because something is happening. Obviously, many of the healers are successful in doing what they do. The possibility, though, is that the kind of energy that they're generating could be out of the realm of what we know.
Uh-huh. So
that's certainly possible.
Sure.
But right now we're trying to see whether we can pick up conventional types of energy from those healers.
Sure.
Very exciting.
And I know that I've been a subject of research where where Konstantin Krotkov's people have actually looked at the light surrounding a person's body sort of before and after. And it's like the light tends to be thicker and more filled in certain areas. You know, what's known as the aura, there's actually scientific biofield that they are analyzing. And I kind of wonder that connection to easy water. It's just this brings up so many questions in my mind. I'm sure that you've got lots of questions, too.
We have a lot of questions that we're trying to answer in the laboratory. And one of the issues is keeping the lab going in a reasonable way, because the people who challenge the scientific consensus always, I thought I had been the exception until recently, always run into difficulty because
sure.
the people who make the decisions on funding the laboratory are the very people who are being challenged. So it's like the French Revolutionary is going to Louis the 16th and says, you know, we have a few issues with you. Will you please listen to us? Well, you know, fat chance.
so I really appreciate those of you who are leading the revolution in you know, your particular way. And, you know, we're going to be ending a little early so that people can hear again at the very end about the presentation, how they can connect with you. Your website is pollacklab.org. That's Pollacklab. If you want to learn more about Dr. Gerald Pollack, I suggest you go there. And also his wonderful book, The Fourth Phase of Water, beyond solid, liquid, and vapor. Jerry, thank you so much for joining us here today. It's been a pleasure, and I'm looking forward to meeting you in person tomorrow evening.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Well, good that you're going to be there. And thank you, Christine. It's been a pleasure.
And thank you for joining us here today. And again, tune in to learn about this presentation tomorrow evening. Bye, everybody.
You've been listening to The Christine Upchurch Show, stellar conversations to illuminate your journey. Each week, this show engages some of the most outstanding visionaries on the planet in lively dialogue to inspire you to become that bright light you're meant to be. Join Christine every Friday at 11 a.m. Pacific Time on KKNW, AM 1150, and TransformationTalkRadio.com. For more information about the transformative healing work of Christine, visit www.StellarReflections.com. And for weekly topics, visit www.TransformationTalkRadio.com.